cover a little material which I really intended to cover at the end of the last lecture but didn't get around to it, on the relationship between Ginzburg-Landau theory and the microscopic BCS model. And then I want to spend the rest of the lecture at least starting off on the subject of Joseph's injunctions, such, because very fundamental aspect of this course. Well, just to recap, you might remember that the Ginzburg-Landau theory of superconductivity is a special case of the Landau-Lifshitz theory of second-order phase transitions, and was actually developed before the advent of a microscopic theory, the BCS theory. Now, what is nice about the Ginzburg-Landau theory is that it enables you to deal with situations which in one way or another are not in bulk equilibrium in a rather straightforward and elegant way. Why would you be worried? Why might you be interested in this kind of situation? Well, for example, let's say the BCS theory, at least in its simple form, just deals with uniform, effectively infinite bulk superconductor. Of course, in real life, you don't usually have that. You always have some kind of boundary of a sample, and there may be some constraints which the order parameter has to satisfy at the edge of the sample. So that would mean that the BCS theory in its original form at least won't go through, whereas the Ginzburg-Landau theory has a relatively simple adaptation to this. The second kind of situation, where you might be interested in, if you like, effects which go away from the strictly equilibrium BCS theories, if you consider fluctuations. Now, in fact, it turns out that in traditional superconductors, the ones which BCS were handling, in three-dimensional bulk, fluctuations really are rather unimportant. They really only have effects very, very close to the transition itself. So it's a bit of a sort of specialist subject. But it turns out when you come to more general theories of superconductivity, in particular, you're interested in things like the cube parades, then fluctuations are, in fact, very important. And so you do have to worry about them. So in other words, what we want to do, basically, is to try to formulate a theory which will deal with circumstances when the order parameter doesn't necessarily have its bulk three-dimensional equilibrium value, more general situations than that. Okay, so as I say, Ginzburg and Landau did indeed write down such a theory, but it was phenomenological. And the question is, you know, how's that related to BCS? So you had a question? Sure, on a torus it would be fine, but very often experimentally you might have, for example, a boundary either with vacuum or with a normal metal. So it's that kind of boundary condition I was thinking of. okay, so I'm going to give you a very, very sketchy account of how you might try to derive the Ginzburg-Landau theory from BCS. I really won't go into all the numerical and technical details here, but I'd like to see the main scheme of how it works. So first of all, what I've actually done in the slides just refers to the bulk terms in the Ginzburg-Landau theory, not the bending terms. We will say a little about the bending terms in a moment. Okay, so first of all, how do we actually define the order parameter corresponding to Ginzburg-Landau in the BCS theory? Well, there are various possibilities, and in particular, the overall normalization of the order parameter is really a matter of convention. So, but the simplest definition, I think, is simply to take the order parameter to be the pair wave function for two opposite spins at the origin, and if the situation is spatially uniform, then that's given in BCS theory by simply this expression here. So, and remember in the Anderson pseudo-spin model, what does that correspond to? Remember that the longitudinal component of of spin, as it were, corresponds to the occupation numbers, but the transverse component corresponds to this quantity here. So in the Anderson pseudospin model, this quantity is just the total transverse pseudospin. Now, that has the nice property that quite independently of whether I'm in equilibrium or not, the BCS pairing terms in the potential, remember these are just the ones which only involve these anomalous averages here, those are always given by this simple expression here. Okay? And that, as I say, that's completely independent of whether I'm in or near equilibrium or not. So that term is straightforward. What's not so straightforward is the other part of the problem. We want to find the minimum value of F. Remember that what Ginsburg and Landau do is to write down the free energy as a function of psi. So we want to find the minimum value of F for a given value of psi, which in general will be a non-equilibrium value. Now, before I go on to the actual the situation which is actually closest interest for comparison with Ginsburg-Landau, which is close to TC. Remember that Ginsburg-Landau theory is basically a theory of the phase transition. So it refers to what happens close to the transition temperature. However, let's look at this problem a little more generally. Suppose that one wanted to, for example, suppose one was at zero temperature. What would you have to do? Well, remember in the Anderson pseudospin model, you have these pseudospins, which in the normal state have a very simple behavior. They're just oriented up above the Fermi surface and down below. Just simply saying that you have complete occupation of the states below the Fermi surface and none above. Now, in the superconducting state, in general, they're going to have this transverse component which corresponds to this quantity here. So then the question one has to ask oneself, is if one was interested in doing this at zero temperature, would be, okay, what's the minimum value of the kinetic energy for a given value of the transverse spin? See, I think it's immediately clear that the moment you go from this situation here, this is the normal state situation where energy runs upwards here and down with the Fermi energy here, okay, you're going to go from that to a situation in which you have something more like this. And now you see, it's clear that introducing this transverse component of pseudospin is going to cost you in the longitudinal component. That is, you're going to have to reduce the polarization up here, You're going to have to occupy some of the states up here, which in the normal state were unoccupied, and you're going to have to vacate some of the states below the Fermi surface, which in the normal state were occupied. So the question is, how much energy does that cost you? Well, one can work that out. In fact, it's a relatively straightforward calculation. The only thing that's slightly awkward about it is that when you do that, you find that at the end of the day, the ground state energy is not an analytic function of psi. It contains logarithms. And the reason for that, I think you can see intuitively in the following way. If you write down an expression, just go back for the moment to the original equilibrium BCS theory, then the quantity psi would be given by The quantity psi in equilibrium BCS theory is given by sum over k delta k over 2ek. If you turn that into an integral, it goes to integral some constants times delta times the integral of dE over root epsilon squared plus delta squared. Now, if you study the behavior of that integral, it's a nasty one. It's logarithmically divergent. The upper divergence occurs at the cutoff energy here, and the lower cutoff occurs at delta. So you get in your expression for psi, you get a logarithm of delta occurring. So that really isn't working terribly well. Actually, that is quite a good idea, yes. No, I think the red one should work, hopefully. That's,
you're good?
Well, let's just see. Let's just see if the red one works. Okay, that one looks fine. Okay, so this goes as log EC of delta. Right? So you get this logarithmic dependence on delta, and if you actually write down, as I say, you write down an expression for the free energy as a function of psi, but it does have this logarithmic dependence actually on psi itself. So that's a bit messy and doesn't make direct contact with Ginzburg-Landau. Okay, so what we want to do rather is to examine what happens close to TC. So we do have to work at finite temperature. And you consider the general BCS density matrix at finite temperature. Again, we take it, if you like, this is a definition of BCS-like states. We take it to be simply a product of the density matrices referring to this individual subspaces, k up and minus k down. These need not be the equilibrium ones. However, we do assume that for a given value of psi, we have temperature, we have equilibrium with respect to temperature. In other words, we assume that this does have the usual Maxwell-Gibbs distribution. Therefore, we can define a partition function in the usual way. Here's our definition of the partition function, free energy in terms of that. And you see that because Z has this product structure, then the free energy is just the sum of the contribution. Yes? Yes, yeah, crudely speaking, it is. Or more precisely, it'll be F squared. It'll be psi squared, which is the number of Cooper pairs. Yes, right. Yes.
You have two raising operators there.
That's right.
So it's...
Okay, so this is the... you could only do this because of the... formally, you could only do this because of the BCS assumption that total particle number is not conserved. If you don't like that, and in fact I don't very much, you can find an appropriate definition of F in terms of the two-particle density matrix, which essentially comes to the same thing. Okay, so we have this, the free energy then, now has this rather nice property that's just the sum over contributions from the different Ks. Now, here comes the crucial point. You can handle the constraint problem. Remember, the only constraint you have is that psi should not has some value which is not necessarily its equilibrium value. But apart from that, you assume that you do have temperature equilibrium and so forth. So the standard way of handling the problem with constraints, of course, is by introducing a Lagrange multiplier. In this case, the Lagrange multiplier is for the quantity which is... Sorry, did I do something? Sorry, the down... which key, sorry? The quantity I have to multiply by my Lagrange multiplier is the quantity whose value I want to fix, which is psi. So in other words, we must now minimize this expression here. Now, okay, this is a slightly tricky point here. Let me just go over it quickly and come back to it for a moment. Essentially, this is just the BCS problem with delta, the standard delta, replaced by lambda. So it's, okay, so how to put it exactly? It's the problem of the Anderson pseudospins, but in a transverse field. Remember, delta is essentially a transverse field. Now, in BCS theory, delta would be given by simply V0 times psi. That's the equilibrium value. Now it's not necessary; does not necessarily have its equilibrium value. This is the slightly tricky point, I think. However, the structure of the problem is exactly the same as the original BCS problem. So rho k has exactly the same structure, and we get there's always going to be a delta-independent constant, which simply has to do with where you fix your zero of energy. So we can forget about that. And so you get zk of delta is given by this expression here. Moreover, psi is given, again, just as in the BCS problem, in terms of the effective field delta in this expression here. How did this come about? Well, this came about simply because in the Anderson pseudo-spin model, this representation, this quantity here is simply delta over EK. So, prima facie at least, all we need to do is to find this expression here in terms of, as a function of this expression here. That's not quite right, and we'll just come back to that in a moment. Now, I'm not going to go into all the gory details of this, but I think it's fairly obvious that since the only, apart from the initial delta here, the only dependence on delta is through delta squared. Remember your definition of EK. EK was just equal to EK squared plus delta squared to the half. So the only dependence of this expression is through delta squared. That means that psi can be expanded and as a series in, delta times something proportional to delta squared. Similarly, the free energy, again, from the expression we just had, is given by a constant independent of delta plus this series expansion. So all you have to do is just to mess around with these two equations and express f of psi as a power series in psi squared. Right? And so I think it's fairly obvious you can do that. It's just a matter of having to do the algebra and get the coefficients right. Now, there is actually one rather slightly tricky point here. We don't actually want f of delta itself, because in calculating f of delta itself, we assumed, as it were, that we had equilibrium for that particular value of delta. What we really want to do is to calculate the sum of two expressions. One is the potential energy, which is always given in terms of psi by that expression here, and the other is actually the sum of the kinetic energy plus the entropy terms. And it turns out that those can be expressed in this form here. That's not immediately obvious, I think, but all that does is just to change the structure of the coefficients very slightly. But anyway, at the end of the day, I think you can see it intuitively without going through all the arithmetic, you do actually come out with an expression which has this form. There's a constant, that is a function of temperature which is independent of psi. Then the coefficient of psi squared, and this is the crucial point really, that has two contributions. The first is the explicit contribution from the interaction here, and the second is this piece which came out of a combination of these here. Okay, so that's the extra cost in kinetic energy and entropy which you needed to pay to get a certain transverse component of your superscript. And then you also see that you automatically get these terms in part of the fourth and so forth. Moreover, nicely it comes out, again I haven't gone through the details of this, that the function A of t is given by an expression of this type here. That then is decreasing as I decrease the temperature. So at high temperatures, this whole thing is positive. And then there's a critical temperature, Tc, at which this becomes equal to zero, which is given by equating this to V0. And in fact, that gives you precisely the BCS expression for the transition temperature. And then you can also get out what explicitly these other functions here are. But what's reassuring is that this, as I've continued to try to emphasise, this is an expression which should be valid even when psi is not given by its equilibrium value. However, if you demand that you do give psi the expression which minimises f, then you just get back to the original BCS theory. And everything comes out very nicely. This works beautifully close to Tc. Can you extend it away from Tc? Yes, you can in principle. You've got to add terms in psi to the sixth, etc., etc., and eventually you find as you go to zero temperature, they no longer converge and you get this logarithmic expression instead. So it's a bit messy, and people don't usually do it, but you could, in fact. But I think, you see, as it was the conceptual picture which is important here, not the not the details of the actual algebraic formula. Now, so far so good. I've at least sketched. Incidentally, all of this is done in gory detail in one of the appendices of my book, if anyone wants to look it up. And I've tried to get the coefficients right, etc. So that's the general scheme of getting the bulk terms. Now, what about the bending terms? Can you get those out? Can you derive the bending terms in Ginzburg-Landau from BCS theory? And the answer is yes, but it's really not quite so straightforward. Oddly enough, there are we can consider two situations. The order parameter may change in space because its phase is changing, or it may change because its amplitude is changing. And you might perhaps think that the case where the amplitude is changing is simpler, but that's actually quite wrong. It's the case where the phase is changing, which is simpler, because that basically corresponds to flow of the superfluid. You remember that if you, in an ordinary Schrodinger problem, if you have a phase change in space, that's basically e to the ik dot r, as it were, that corresponds to a finite momentum. Similarly, in the case of a superfluid, we already saw that in the Ginzburg-Landau theory, the expression for the current is given by j of r is psi star grad psi with an ih bar or whatever over m minus cc. Okay, so and this then can be rewritten as psi squared grad phi, where phi is the phase. So a phase gradient then corresponds. This is more general in the theory of superfluidity and superconductivity. A phase gradient of the order parameter generally corresponds to superfluid flow. And it turns out there's a nice way of calculating the energy associated with superfluid flow, which I won't go into in detail unless anyone's interested. It's an argument due to Landau way back in 1940 or so. It gives you precisely the energy associated with the flow of the superfluid, basically gives you the superfluid density. So far, so good. So you get out the phase bending terms very nicely. What about the amplitude bending terms? I don't know, actually, of any intuitive way of getting that out. The only way the only argument I know for that is to go back to Ginzburg and Landau's original argument, which invoked the fact that the order parameter, that the dependence on the gradients, the small psi, had to be proportional to the complex analytic expression, grad psi squared. Now you see, if you believe that, then you can say at once that there's a relationship between the energy associated with bending of the magnitude of the order parameter and the energy associated with bending of the phase. In fact, this is just, what is it? It's grad mod psi squared plus mod psi squared grad phi squared. In other words, you have the same coefficient for these two terms. But to believe that, you've got to believe that Landau and Ginzburg's original argument, this has to be an analytic function of grad psi, which to me is not obvious. Now, Gorkov did, in his famous 1959 paper, actually derive that result from the original BCS theory, but it does require the use of Green's function methods, which I find non-intuitive, so I haven't tried to go through it here. But as I say, if you're willing to swallow that one condition, then fine, you can get out all the bending terms and therefore the whole of Ginzburg-Landau theory out of BCS. Okay, let me just stop. That really completes what I wanted to say about the relationship between BCS and Ginzburg-Landau. Hopefully I haven't totally confused you all. any questions or comments? Yeah. How do I deal with the system far away from TC? Fine. Okay. All of this stuff, in some sense, does go through at least qualitatively. What I would have to do is to actually solve explicitly the problem of what is, remember, okay, bulk terms first. In the bulk term, the potential energy is always minus V0 times psi squared. And as I've emphasized, that's independent of whether I'm near TC or far from TC, whether I'm in equilibrium or not, whatever. Okay. The difficult bit is to get out the minimum change in the quantity, let's call it K, which is kinetic energy minus mu n plus T minus Ts, the entropy term. To get the minimum value of that as a function of mod psi, or more precisely mod psi squared. And, I mean, you can do it, but it's a messy calculation in general. And, in fact, you could formally express the result as a power series in psi, but as I say, as T goes to zero, at least that will not converge. So you get this log expression. As to the bending terms, there's an interesting point about the bending terms, which is, I think, not often appreciated. All that Ginsburg and Landau ever said is that if, as it were, the only reference to psi is explicitly through this, then they claimed it has to be analytic, that is, the coefficient of the amplitude bending and the phase bending terms had to be the same. Now, the interesting question is, does that still apply when you're far from TC? Because when you're far from TC, you can afford to put a function of some non-trivial function of psi squared in here as well. And the answer is no, it doesn't. In fact, it turns out that at zero temperature, the coefficient of this term is three times the coefficient of this one here. So that's not I don't know of any really intuitive way of deriving that result. If anyone's interested, I and some of my students and Mike Stone and his students have a paper way back on this. But the argument is very lengthy and messy, and so forth. So generally speaking, I think what we can be confident of is that the general scheme of the Ginsburg-Landau theory does go through, however far I am from TC. But the actual coefficients may be incredibly messy functions. That's the only problem. Okay, any other questions, comments? Okay, then let's start on what was supposed to be the main topic of this lecture, which is the Josephson effect. And I'm going to start in this lecture and the next one. I'm going to basically talk about the Josephson effect at what you might call the classical level. That's, crudely speaking, the level at which Josephson originally found it, and the level at which it tended to be discussed for the first 20-odd years of the subject. As we'll see, some of the most interesting phenomena associated with the Josephson effect are precisely those which go beyond the classical level, but let's certainly start with that. Okay, so the Josephson effect, well, it's actually a rather generic kind of phenomenon. Crudely speaking, it's a class of characteristic effects associated with the tunneling, or more generally, the transport of Cooper pairs across what we call a weak link separating two bulk superconductors. So the weak link is both basically anything which weakens the contact, the degree of contact which you would have in the bulk superconductor. So if you like, think of it as a sort of gate which allows Cooper pairs to pass, but with some kind of increased difficulty. Now, in real life, there are a number of different types of weak link. The original one, which Josephson himself discussed, and in some sense the simplest one, is a tunnel oxide junction. Typically, you might have a bulk superconductor, call it R, right here. And on top of that, you might lay some kind of oxide film. Very often, even if you don't do it, nature is going to do it for you. So you'll get this film laid on top of your superconductor, and you superpose a second superconductor on top of that. And nowadays, people have got very, very sophisticated at doing this kind of thing. And for example, typical materials in the barrier might be say, aluminum oxide or niobium oxide or whatever, you see incidentally that both, it's not a coincidence, both aluminum and niobium are bulk superconductors. So very often you'd get, for example, an aluminum superconductor with an overlay of aluminum 203 followed by a second aluminum, etc., etc. And generally speaking, these oxides are pretty good insulators. And if I'm going to get any kind of reasonable critical current, we'll come to that in a moment, but if the critical current is going to have any kind of reasonable value, they better not be too thick. So typically these Josephson tunnel oxide junctions are less than about 30 angstroms or so. 10 angstroms would be a very typical value for this. And for reasons we'll see, these are, this kind of oxide junction is typically non-hysteretic. Incidentally, in future slides, I'm going to be referring to these junctions as TOBs. That's tunnel oxide barriers. Okay, so try to remember that. Second kind of junction is a so-called Diane bridge. That's essentially a narrow wire or slab, and typically you have transverse dimensions which are small compared to the pair radius. Strictly speaking here, I should not be using the pair radius but rather the Ginzburg-Landau healing length, which does behave rather differently. It diverges as it goes to TC. But for simplicity, let me just say for the moment the pair radius here. Sorry? Well, yes. I mean, I think the point of having D much less than the xi is simply that you, as it were, weaken the contact between the bulk superconductors. I mean, if D is much greater than xi, then basically you just regard the bridge as part of the bulk. So that's really the only reason here. And the length typically might be of the order of the pair radius. It could be much longer in some cases. In fact, nowadays, for example, people like my colleague at Illinois, Alexei Bezradin, do lots of experiments with long, thin wires, and they're very interested in their own right, but probably one would normally count those as Josephson junctions, I think. A third type of, incidentally, these may be hysteretic or non-hysteretic, depending on the parameters. I'll talk later about the question of hysteresis versus non-hysteresis. Finally, we get, one other point. In a Diane bridge, the reason the contact is weakened is primarily that it's simply so narrow. On the other hand, it's possible to take a wider strip and try to depress the superconductivity by, for example, putting it next to a normal metal. It turns out that does tend to suppress superconductivity. So you can make these bridges in various kinds of ways. Finally, you get point contacts. You basically press try to sharpen a metal, say niobium, to something like a point, and press it against a second bulk metal. And you can get, in fact, point contacts as small as, say, 100 square angstroms in cross-section there. Again, these might be hysteretic or non-hysteretic, depending on the choice of the parameters. Sorry?
The behavior of the
third one should be different from the first two. I'm sorry, I didn't catch the
first part of your statement. The behavior of the third one should be different from the first two.
Well,
quantum mechanical effects
will be pronounced in the third. Well, I mean, quantum mechanical effects will turn out to be pronounced in all of them, but it's true that, yes, it's true that in detail the behavior is really rather different. Since you raised the question of Coulomb blockade, let me just say a word about it. Crudely speaking, one normally thinks of Coulomb blockade as an effect which tends to occur when the actual total volume you're tunneling into, that is what we call the bulk here, is actually not bulk, but something much smaller, some kind of mesoscopic grain. That's a very important class of effects. We find then that the capacitance associated with this volume here can be very important. That really, in some sense, would take us on immediately to the subject of quantum effects, as you say, quantum effects in a more extended way. So when we come to deal with, we'll go beyond the classical theory, we'll certainly come to that. Okay, so as it stands today, at least, at the classical level, the... please, go ahead. I'm sorry?
I'm afraid I didn't actually find out about Neil's talk.
However, I think I have heard it. I think he gave the same talk essentially at Illinois a month or two ago. So I do roughly know what it's about. However, I certainly don't know what Kandinoff's question. Sorry?
Yeah.
Do you want to tell us what Kandinoff's question was? Can you remember? Well.
Because I'm not confident.
Okay,
I can say it.
Yeah, okay. So,
no.
All right, fine. Okay, so as the theory at the classical level currently stands, it's basically... there are basically two types of theory. There's a sort of phenomenological theory, which is applicable to all types of junction, and a microscopic theory, at least for some types, but that does depend, tend to depend on the specifics of the junction in question. So let's start off, if you like, with a sort of what you might call a semi-phenomenological generic attempt to describe the Josephson effect. And before we actually get into the dynamics, which are in some sense the interesting part, we have to discuss what you might call the kinematics of the Josephson effect, that is the nature of the many-body wave functions which are likely to occur in it. A very nice discussion of this, which actually uses the idea that your junction is not isolated but part of what we now call a flux qubit, is given by Felix Bloch, in this paper in 1970, which I would certainly strongly recommend to anyone who's seriously interested in this. My approach is not identical to that of Bloch, but it's very much in the same spirit. So remember that rather generally we define for a pretty much arbitrary system of fermions, we define a fully paired BCS state in the following way. That is a normalization here, N, have an antisymmetrizer, A, but apart from that, the wave function is just the product of a whole set of two-particle wave functions, and the crucial point is that these are identical. So if 1 and 2 are paired in a particular molecular state, then so are 3 and 4 in the identical state, etc., etc. The only thing to remember is that at the end of the day, you do have to antisymmetrize it. So this is actually not a terribly convenient description for actual calculations, but it does help to intuit what's going on with it. Here I've suppressed the spin index in the wave function just so as not to clutter up the notation more than necessary. Now, if the barrier, that is the tunnel oxide, for example, the tunnel oxide barrier, if it's very high, then it's plausible to write the wave function. Well, first of all, because we can always write it as a function of the relative and centre of mass coordinates, but then let's take out the centre of mass coordinates and isolate two terms which correspond roughly to being on the left and the right of the barrier. So the centre of mass of phi, L and R is localised on the left and right sides, as the case may be. And you have... Now, the question of normalization is always a bit of a pain in this discussion. I'm just going to say, well, for the moment, we'll let phi, L, and R have some fixed normalization. Don't worry too much about what it is, so strictly speaking, you should be more careful. Following what we did for the bulk superconductor in lecture 2, and assuming that these two individual wave functions are approximately independent of the centre of mass coordinate within the bulk superconductors. Okay, so let's go back for a moment. So basically we've got phi L is pretty much constant as a function of the centre of mass here, and similarly phi R over here. So we can then write this as some pair creation operator acting on the vacuum, and similarly phi r. Again, we have to worry a little about normalization. I'm going to choose the normalization. The CKL. Yeah. The normalization is such that you create a normalized state of M particles on the left or right side, respectively. Now, from now on, we're going to basically assume that within the left and right superconductor separately, the pair wave function has taken its equilibrium value, right? Because the energies, I mean, the rationale for this is that the energies associated with the formation of Cooper pairs in bulk is very large compared to the energies associated with tunneling through the junction. So basically, we should be able to regard the Cooper pairs on the left-hand side as being essentially in infinite, the same kind of equilibrium that would be in infinite bulk, and ditto for the right-hand side. By the same argument as we used in lecture 2 for the single bulk case, we can now write our many-body wave function in this form here. So, crucial point to notice here is, well, two things. What have we done? In words, as it were, what have we done here? What we've done is to define a Cooper pair wave function, which is a linear combination of states on the left of a state which is on the left of the barrier and a state which is on the right, right? And then we've raised that to the n over 2th power. So in other words, we've put n over 2 Cooper pairs into that same state. Well, not exactly n over 2. We'll come back to that point. But we've essentially required that all the electrons are in this state. So let me emphasize very strongly, this is not anything like a Schrodinger cat-like state. A Schrodinger cat-like state might be constructed by taking this to the n over 2 plus this to the n over 2, right? Those, in other words, you have a quantum superposition of a state in which all the Cooper pairs are on one side and all on the other, and that's very Schrodinger's catty. That's not the kind of state we want to consider for present purposes, right? This is rather a state in which each Cooper pair is partly on the left and partly on the right, and all the Cooper pairs are in this same state. Okay? So it's
very small cat state.
So it's, in some sense, it's pretty much like the state of a laser in which each individual photon is in a linear superposition of being, say, at one slit or the other, but then all the photons are in the same state. Now, crucial point. This is, by construction, this state is an eigenstate of the total number of electrons, which is just n. But it's not an eigenstate of the relative number of electrons, number on the left minus the number on the right. Right? Absolutely no reason why it should be. There's no superselection rule which requires this. And the moment, I did say let's consider a very, very high barrier, but you know, it's not infinite, and there is a possibility for electrons to migrate from the left to the right. So there's absolutely no reason why we should... let me emphasise. We're not just saying here that the number of particles on the left is not fixed and is fluctuating. We're saying there's a definite phase relationship between the states in which there are different numbers of electrons on the left and different on the right. Yes? Yes, yes. That is, you're basically assuming that, let's say, within either of the bulk superconductors, the state of the Cooper pair is pretty much what it would be a single infinite bulk. Yep.
Does that... like if you were to take two superconductors and slowly bring them together?
Yes.
Would you get
that? very, very good question, which has actually been discussed explicitly in the literature at various points. You'd have to specify rather carefully, I think, how you prepared these things. If you prepare them by weighing the sample very carefully and rejecting any sample let's say you require that you have exactly 10 to the 23 particles, so here in one, and exactly 10 to the 23 in the other, you reject all samples that don't have that property. Okay, so you now know for sure that you've got an exact number here and an exact number here. That's a so-called, what we call technically a Fock state, relative Fock state. Now you bring them together, and now it really becomes a question of the energetics and dynamics. If there's any reasonable degree of tunneling, what's liable to happen is that you'll get a sufficient degree of tunneling across the barrier between them so that after a short non-equilibrium period, you're likely to end up in a state like this. We'll see later why a state like this tends to be energetically favoured. But I think you can see, perhaps intuitively, that it's in some sense advantageous to have the relative phase of the Cooper pairs on the left and right adjusted appropriately. So, and if you don't, that's going to cost you some extra energy. So we'll see that in more detail.
Yes.
No, of course not. No. Yeah, they will be different. Yes, and there will be, in fact, fluctuations and uncertainties. However, what I think is important is that if they are, if you did start off with them infinitely far apart, and they have, as it were, no history, then initially they should not contain the superposition of states of different particle number. There may be a mixture, a classical mixture. Whereas this is very definitely a quantum superposition of states on which there's a particular number on the left and the appropriate missing number on the right. So we can, in fact, we can write out explicitly. If M is the, let's see, I'm taking M here to be the number on the left, I guess. Again, you have to be very careful about factors of two in the accounting here, but... if M is the number on the left, then you can expand this quantity by the standard binomial expansion, and you see that you get these coefficients here. And provided that the relative phase of these is not something which is totally arbitrary but is fixed, then in general you see you have got a quantum superposition of states of different M here, and not just a mixture. So this state is clearly not an eigenvalue, an eigenfunction, sorry, it's not an eigenfunction of the operator NL minus NR. However, it turns out that by the standard properties of the binomial expansion, provided that both the superconductors are large, so that the total numbers involved are, you know, the order of 10 to the 23 or something of the kind, then the distribution of delta n's is in fact strongly peaked around its average value. And according to the properties of the binomial distribution, that's given by this expression here. It's actually convenient to do one of two things at this point, just so as to clear up some technical mess which would otherwise occur. We're either going to assume that the two bulk superconductors are pretty much similar, that is, they have the same volume and therefore the same equilibrium number of particles, etc. Or alternatively, we can simply adjust the definitions of AL and AR to make sure that this delta N, in general, the expectation value is close to zero. So that's simply a matter of accounting, nothing fundamental. Okay. Now, here, this is a rather important point on this slide. The quantities A left and A right, they're complex amplitudes, so they have an amplitude and a phase. An overall phase factor can always be taken out. That will simply multiply your whole wave function by some e to the I n phi. And that's just an overall phase factor multiplying your whole many-body wave function. That can't have any physical effect. So you can always take that out. In other words, we can always arbitrarily adjust the overall phase factor so that we can write them in this form here. So delta phi here is the relative phase of the Cooper pairs on the left and the right. Now, here comes an important point. Let's look at the operator d by d delta phi in the delta n or m representation. Remember, M was the number on the left, sorry. Now you have several considerations. First of all, states of different M are mutually orthogonal. Secondly, the functions phi L and phi right, that is the molecular wave functions corresponding to being on the left or the right, those are, again, mutually orthogonal, since we're talking about two different regions of space. And thirdly, both the states psi n and psi n minus 2, they're both normalized. And so you can use these relations. I'm sorry, something gone wrong here. This should be n, not n. Sorry, just correct that in the notes. It turns out that if you explicitly take the derivative with respect to delta phi in here, you find this product here, which is just given by this. And moreover, the matrix in this representation, because the states M and N prime were mutually orthogonal, that tells you that the off-diagonal elements are zero. And therefore, in the M representation, the operator I d by d delta phi is given by this expression here. It's a diagonal operator, and its diagonal elements are given by this. Now let's compare that with the operator delta n in the same representation. Well, trivially, delta n is, apart from a constant, is just m in effect. So the off-diagonal elements of that operator are trivially zero. The diagonal elements do depend on m. In general, this is different for the different states. However, the fluctuations around the average value are very small. They're of order n, total n to the minus half. And so you find that this operator here is just given by this. So you've basically got the same expression given apart from a factor of 4 for these two different expressions. So that what that tells you is that delta n can be regarded as a differential operator with respect to delta phi. In other words, apart from this trivial factor of 4, the relative number of particles on the two sides of the junction and the relative phase of the Cooper pair wave function across the junction are canonically conjugate variables to one another. That's the crucial result. Now, this is not a terribly rigorous way of deriving that result. You can do a little better, and for example, in my book, again, I'll try to do it, it'll be slightly more quantitative than that, but this is really a rather fundamental result regarding Josephson junctions. Notice, incidentally, that it's the total number. Well, first of all, trivial point, why the factor of 4? As I say, that's a matter of accounting and definition. Crudely speaking, one factor of 2 comes from the fact that delta phi refers to the Cooper pairs, whereas n refers to single electrons. The second point, which is trivial but keeps causing confusion, unfortunately, is that you've defined delta n as the difference in nl and nr, not as nl, say. And again, you could perfectly well put in a factor of 2 in that definition if you wanted to. But ideally, you want to try to keep these factors of 2 straight because they do screw things up if you get them wrong. Okay, so that really is rather crucial, that result. So let me just stop for a moment and ask you a question. Yeah, absolutely. Yes. So, okay. Let me anticipate. Good question. Let me just anticipate something I was going to say a bit later at this point. Generally speaking, when discussing the classical Josephson effect, you tend to implicitly assume that delta phi is rather well defined. That is, you can treat the relative phase of the Cooper pairs across the junction as a classical quantity. That of course, now means that delta n has to be large, but in fact, it doesn't have to be all that large. As we've seen, the root mean square fluctuations are of order n to the half, not of order n. Right? So relative to the total number of particles, assuming that this really is very large, then delta n is still relatively small. Now, Prajee raised the point. What happens if we were to consider a state in which delta n is very well defined? In other words, a state that does indeed correspond to a definite number of particles on the left and a definite number on the right. And so that's what we would call technically a relative Fock state. Okay. Now in that case, as she points out, this means that delta phi is completely undefined. That's fine. That's exactly what we'd expect. I mean, if you just go back, I wouldn't exactly call it a singularity. I mean, I think the situation is conceptually not very different from what you get in the case of a single particle. Imagine a single particle which can be shared, as it were, between two boxes, which have some kind of rather high partition between them. You can certainly consider a state in which the particle is localized on one side of the box rather than the other. But if you do, then very clearly the whole concept of relative phase has disappeared. Okay.
Have you, by taking delta phi in the relative phase, have you lost the geometric phase in between for some reason?
Geometric phase?
Yeah. Is there a geometric phase making any difference, any importance?
Well, look, I think right now we're talking about the simplest possible case where your Cooper pair wave function is simply a complex scalar object. Generally speaking, to introduce the idea of geometric phase and have it get interesting results, you have to have something a little more sophisticated than that. For example, you have to have an SU2 kind of symmetry. And we could talk about that, but I think it's not going to come up at this point. Okay. Yeah, so I already ran through this point. In the classical theory, basically, delta phi is fixed, delta n has large fluctuations. Eventually, we are going to have to treat cases where the fluctuations of delta phi are large, so you're close to an eigenstate of delta n. That's a relative Fock state. However, provided only that the root mean square fluctuation of n is small compared to the total number of n, then this commutation relation is essentially still valid. So this is actually valid over a huge range, which is essentially the whole range you're ever going to need at least for the Josephson effect as it was originally realized in classic superconductors. Now there are a few cases in different other systems, like say ultra-cold atomic gases, where you might get out of this situation. But generally speaking, I mean the point is that, you know, if you've got two bulk superconductors, then no matter how much there's tunneling between them and so forth, the total number of electrons in one of the bulk superconductors can never fluctuate much out of its original value, simply because it's going to cost you such an enormous amount in capacitance energy. Okay, second point, this is just a note really. I've deliberately worked in a scheme which conserves total number of particles. However, if you want to, you can equally well proceed as BCS did for the single volume case. That is, you replace this whole operator here by an exponential, and now you see that your wave function is in fact a product of wave functions for your individual, the two sides individually. So now, again, you define, just as in lecture 2, you define ULs and VLs, but you define them separately for the left and right sides. And essentially the argument goes through exactly the same, except you have to realise this rather messy point about normalisation, which requires you to make this substitution here. But apart from that, everything goes through exactly as in the single superconductor case. You can define your Fs and Vs, and so in the standard way, and now delta phi is nothing but the relative phase of the order parameter on the left and right side. So basically you think of delta phi, or define delta phi in two ways which turn out to be essentially equivalent for present purposes. Either you can say it's the relative phase of the molecular wave function, remember this phi sub L, phi sub right on the two sides, which makes, in some sense, makes the optimum contact with the single particle case. Alternatively, you can define an order parameter in the BCS particle non-conserving scheme, and you say it's just the relative phase of the order parameter on the two sides. Then, of course, having done that, you now want to recover a many-body state which has a definite total number of particles, all I've got to do is to define an overall phase of the U's and V's and then integrate over that, just as I did in the single particle case. So it doesn't matter what language one uses, basically. Okay. Let's see. Yes, I should be able to at least get started on the dynamics. Yes. Okay, so two famous equations which Josephson wrote down in his famous number 62 paper. One is an equation for the current across the junction in terms of the relative phase difference. And the second tells you the rate of evolution of the relative phase. Now, these two equations really have slightly different status. Equation J1, that's this one here, is actually somewhat specific to the tunnel oxide barrier. Remember, TOB is tunnel oxide barrier. Tunnel oxide barrier that Josephson was considering. And it's actually a special case of a more general relation. Whereas J2 is a much more generic relation and does essentially apply to all varieties of Josephson junction. Okay, so let's start off by imagining for the moment that the barrier between the two bulk superconductors is infinitely high, so that at least over the time scale of the experiment, I don't have to worry about any transport of electrons between them. And then, remember I had an equation, let's just go back to that for one moment. Here we go. I had this rather messy looking equation here, which involved these coefficients for these were coefficients of the specific states involving a definite number of particles on the left and right. So, I'm sorry. So just to simplify the notation a little, we'll define a state in which there are m particles on the left of the barrier and m cubic pairs. Remember, m is the number of cubic pairs, not the single particles. That's one of these factors of two you always have to remember. So this, by definition, we'll just call the state m here. And then the coefficient of that state will be dm. And so my general wave function, which for a reason I'm going to show you, I do want to be a function of time in general as well as space, that'll be given in this representation by this rather simple expression here. Now there's no transport between left and right in the limit we're considering, and therefore m is conserved, which means therefore that the probability of finding state m must be conserved in time. So the mod squared of dm is constant. What about the phase? This is where the interesting part comes in. Let's consider the relative phase of dm and dm minus 1. Now, from our definition of that, the argument of that relative phase is simply minus delta phi of t. Remember, basically this is because you had an e to the I delta phi, which came in, or e to the I delta phi over 2, which came in m minus 1 times in this one and m times in this one. So you can easily check that's right. On the other hand, if you consider the Hamiltonians of the bulk superconductors individually, nothing for the moment connected with the junction, we're just talking about the Hamiltonians of the bulk on each side, then we find that the eigenvalues of this are given by some expression em of t, yeah? So that means, putting that together with this, that this relative phase evolves according to this. So delta phi evolves according to this expression here, or more simply, if we take the derivative of that, we find that the derivative of delta phi is just the difference between the energy of a state in which you have m particles on the left and one in which you have m minus 1 particles on the left. Now, what is that difference in energy? Well, assuming that m is close to its average value, then this quantity is simply the energy which you require to add a single pair to the left superconductor and take one away from the right one. a single crimper pair, which is important. And that is simply twice the chemical potential difference between the right and left. Incidentally, just watch one thing here. We have to be careful. In the case of a superconductor, what we actually mean by the chemical potential. I mean, normally you would be, you'd say the chemical potential of a bulk system is simply the energy you need to add one more particle. But now, alas, you have to be careful, because remember, as we said last time, nature can actually count up to 10 to the 23 modulo 2. So we have to be careful about that modulo 2. Right? In other words, the energy necessary to go from 10 to the 23 to 10 to the 23 plus 1 is not necessarily the same as to go from 10 to the 23 plus 1 to 10 to the 23 plus 2. However, luckily, it is nature can only count modulo 2. So what we have to define, the way we tend to define mu, is the half the energy necessary to add a Cooper pair. Okay. Yes. Okay. Yeah. Okay. So now we get this important relation that the rate of evolution of the relative phase across the Cooper pairs across a junction is twice the chemical potential divided by H-bar, the difference in chemical potential divided by H-bar. Now, in most practical cases, strictly speaking, mu is the electrochemical potential, but in most cases, including the one that Josephson considered, you can approximate delta mu very well by simply the E times the voltage drop across the junction. And therefore, you recover the first Josephson relation, which, just let me remind you, was the second Josephson relation, sorry. I'll use that. Now, there was one implicit assumption in that argument. Namely, we assumed that although n is not, strictly speaking, fixed to its average value, we could still evaluate this energy difference as being more or less independent of n. And that's often true, but not always. In fact, you don't. When we get to discuss mesoscopic systems, we're going to find that we may have to generalise this result in that case. But for the moment, at least, we can make that assumption. OK, so that's the first Josephson relation, I think.
So, to get to this point, you assume that the variable is very high?
Yes, yes.
And with that, I mean...
Well, OK, we're going to find out. Next look at the effect of actual particle transport across the junction. It's a good question. Exactly what am I implicitly assuming here? And I think one of the things I am implicitly assuming, which would certainly fail if I made my barrier arbitrarily strong, as it were, is that the difference in chemical potential across the junction can be regarded as an externally fixed quantity. Something to say that the experimenter controls by applying some kind of voltage or whatever. If I have too much transport across the junction, then that's certainly not going to be true. And we will, in fact, come to the effects of that later. Basically, these are capacitance terms and so forth. OK, any questions or comments? Because the sign is different, you say? I think in the case... OK, the case of BECs. Are you thinking of the BEC-BCS crossover problem, by chance?
I have two BECs.
Two BECs, yes.
And I have a variant.
Yes.
And there's a Josephson
effect. Yes, indeed, there will be, yes. Yes, basically they will. The main difference is quite simply that instead of talking about the wave function of Cooper pairs, you're talking about the wave function of individual particles, individual bosons.
Yeah.
But again, they're just as the Cooper pairs are sort of pseudo Bose condensed, then the single particles are really Bose condensed. And you just have to watch the factors of two and so forth a bit, but apart from that, everything does go through pretty much. So I don't think there's any qualitative difference between these two cases. Does that answer your question?
Yeah, but
Okay, good, yes. Well, that's the case for a non-interacting for a non-interacting gas. The question of what happens to the chemical potential for an interacting Bose system is actually a rather nasty one. There's a famous paper by Hugan Hobbs and Pines way back in the 60s which deals with that. But I don't think this really matters because you see, one is talking about differences in chemical potential here. So the absolute value for either of these BECs separately doesn't really play a role.
But the direction will be a little different.
Sorry?
Sine UL minus UR
will be a little different. Let's just think about that for a moment. In an interacting system, again, I have to define what I mean by the chemical potential. And what I'm, in the case of bosons, that's rather straightforward because I can just say it's the energy necessary to add one more particle. So that should be well defined. If I want to control that experimentally, what would I do? Well, for example, I would physically maybe raise one, in the Earth's gravitational field, I'll just raise one potential well relative to the other. So I think everything does go through pretty much. Okay, so let's in the last few minutes just briefly at least get started on the question of the second of the first Josephson equation. And so this is actually a special case of a more general equation, which will tell you the value of the current across the junction as a function of the phase difference. It may not be as simple as this. And to derive this, it's actually more convenient to discuss not the current directly, but rather the energy associated with a given phase across the junction. We'll call that the phase locking energy. And then relate it to the current by this relation here. So this is a very, very fundamental relation in the theory of Josephson junctions. How do we get that? Well, we actually did derive, or pretend to derive, this commutation relation here. And moreover, apart from a factor of E, which has got left out, I'm afraid, here, the current across the junction is just a half ddt of delta n. The factor of a half is simply because of the way you define delta n. You define it as nl minus nr, not nr separately. The other factor of two, however, has to do with the fact you're talking about cubic pairs. There's a very nice argument by Bloch in his 1970 paper. The only reason I don't use this argument at this point is that it does require you to consider a slightly more sophisticated situation than just a single Josephson junction biased by an external current. You have to put the to bend your leads around to make what we now call a flux qubit. Given that, and given a very general assumption about thermodynamic equilibrium, Bloch has this very neat argument for deriving this result, which in some sense is more physical than this, which is the commutation relation is slightly formal way of doing it. Okay, so we need to consider this E as a function of delta phi. Now, in general, we do expect E to depend on the nature of the junction. But there are a few things we can reasonably say. First of all, delta phi is the phase of a quantum mechanical wave function. And you remember that it's a very generic feature that reversal of phases is equivalent to I going to minus I, and that in turn is equivalent to the operation of time reversal. So if our system is time reversal invariant, and almost all the systems we're going to consider are, then E must be an even function of delta phi. Secondly, E of delta phi must be periodic in delta phi. However, it's important to realize that it's not necessarily a unique function of delta phi. Let me just illustrate that point for a moment. This is a diagram which you've probably seen in various other contexts, in particular in the context of the quantum Hall effect. Imagine that, perhaps not exactly this diagram, but something rather like it. I've got to construct a function E of delta phi, which is going to be periodic as a function of phi. So let delta phi get across here, and this is 2 pi, 4 pi, 6 pi, etc. So something down here. Okay, how can I do that? Well, the most obvious way is to draw a diagram which might look something, let us say, something like this. Okay, that looks perfectly periodic, yeah, delta phi. However, there's another possibility, which is slightly more subtle. Suppose, I have not one, but a number of energy levels. Now, then, for example, I might draw something like, again, put 2 pi, 4 pi, 6 pi. I might draw something like this. Now, that doesn't look periodic, right? However, what I now must do is to draw also, etc. And now you see that even if, for the moment I'm assuming there's no level of repulsion between these guys, you see immediately that one energy, as it were, there is a value of the energy which is periodic in 2 pi. Now, in fact, what's likely to happen in this kind of context is, of course, that you might get some kind of level of repulsion here, and in fact, in which case these would be genuinely now periodic. But in fact, this level crossing, this level repulsion, may be, in practice, extremely small. This is what happens in the theory of the quantum Hall effect, for example. And sorry? Well, I wasn't planning to, but I could. Yes. But if we sweep at any reasonable rate, this splitting may be so small that I sort of ignore it and just go straight up these curves here. So that's the situation where basically I can ignore the level of repulsion and just look at these. This is a situation which does apply to various types of Joseph's injunction, in fact. Anyway, if I'm given this, then at least, as it were, if I define my levels appropriately, I get this type of expansion here. The fact that I have no sine term comes from the fact that it has to be even in delta phi. Finally, again, this is an argument which Bock goes through in much more detail. If E can be expanded in terms of the single particle tunneling matrix element, and this should actually be a little t, then A sub n goes as the 2nth power of t. To convince you, it's maybe not immediately obvious. Crudely speaking, the 2nth power of t, the coefficient A sub n, corresponds to transferring n Cooper pairs across the junction. Well, n Cooper pairs is 2n individual particles, so the single particle tunneling matrix element has to come into the 2nth power. And therefore, one can make a rather general statement. If the single particle tunneling is arbitrarily weak, then you do in fact get the unique result that E of delta phi is minus EJ times cosine of delta phi. And therefore, you indeed get the first Josephson relation. You take the dE by d phi of that and write IC. The critical current is 2 pi over phi 0 divided by, times EJ. This quantity here, 2 pi over phi 0, is just something that's a shorthand for combination of fundamental constants, 2 pi over phi 0 is simply 2e over h here. H bar, sorry. You remember that the definition of phi 0, the superconducting flux quantum, this is not the flux quantum which you normally use in discussing, say, the quantum Hall effect. It's a superconducting flux quantum, and it's h over 2e, not h over e. So you can show rather very, very generically, if the single particle coupling is weak enough, you're always going to get Josephson's original relation. But in more complicated examples, like say point contacts or microbridges, you may well get something more complicated than that, and we'll come to that. I guess it's going to be next time now. So this is actually, I think, quite a good place to stop. So far, we've just discussed the general scheme, as it were, of the Josephson relation, but we can say a lot, quite a bit more than that. And in particular, we can actually in many cases, we can actually try to calculate the energy as a function of the phase drop and see how it comes out. So I'll start off next time by doing that, and then go on to the question of Josephson circuits. What happens if I put a Josephson junction, say with current leads, or I put it in a flux qubit or whatever? Okay, but it'll still be next lecture will still be at this semi-classical level.
Okay, no lecture.
Sorry?
There's no lecture.
No lecture on Tuesday. No, we'll have a lecture next Thursday.
Okay.
Okay.
Because he was, if I understood me, he was talking about that quantum tunneling is a semi-classical element can be expressed, is connected to these complex classical trajectories.
Yeah.
And then Kerenov asked what is the relevance in condition of process induction.
But you see, I think I would need to clarify what Kadanoff meant by that, because clearly, at least for the case of a tunnel oxide barrier, where life is particularly straightforward, the reason you get any finite Josephson coupling at all, that is, you get any E which is not zero, is because of single particle tunneling through the barrier. So he might have been talking about that. On the other hand, we'll see that when you go beyond the semi-classical level, you can think of the relative phase itself as being a variable which tunnels through some kind of potential barrier. So you could have been thinking about that. So I think we'll need to clarify which of the two. Yes. But I remember that Neil does have these ideas about going into the complex plane, which is something which always scares me. I like to stay on the real axis myself if I possibly can. To who, sir? To weak? Weak measurement. Well, okay. Just let me express my prejudice, since you did bring up this subject. I think the ideas which Aharonov and company originally propagated in the late 1980s have been incredibly fruitful and so forth. I think they really did a major disservice by using the word measurement in that context. I don't actually think that weak measurement has much to do with measurement in the sense that I traditionally understand it. What in effect one's was asking is how much can you infer about the behaviour of a system which has interacted in a particularly specified way with some kind of reasonably macroscopic device, and that's whether you call it a measurement or not, maybe a matter of theology, I don't know, but I find it somewhat confusing myself. Okay, so perhaps we can start, we can resume then on Thursday. And as I say, I'll start by discussing at least a little the kind of physical factors which enter into the actual physical, the value of delta J phi, of E. Yeah.